was the oldest and most prominent of Jesus' disciples. He began following Jesus early in Jesus' ministry. He was likely the oldest of the disciples and often the most outspoken. Peter is famous for having denied Jesus three times after Jesus' arrest. Peter appears in all of the Easter stories, getting and bearing witness to the empty tomb. And Peter also has the uncomfortable distinction of Jesus' special attention in John 21, where Jesus asks him three times, "Peter, do you love me?" Now it's important to recognize that Peter's life with Jesus was complicated. From what we know of Peter, he was likely a reasonably successful middle-class tradesman. Being a fisherman in the Galilee at that point was a middle-class lifestyle. It was a dependable occupation. He had equipment. He had responsibility. And so when Jesus calls Peter and he leaves his business to follow him, it's a significant thing. But then, of course, as you know, after we do find Peter fishing in John 21, a fishing trip that throughout the years has been scorned by Bible readers and commentators. How dare he go back to fishing? But from what we know of Peter, he spent the rest of his life as sort of an itinerant preacher. I'm sure his business suffered from neglect, or he sold it. And then he, like some of the other apostles, began traveling around the Roman Empire and was subject to the conflicts of the early church. There was one point in the book of Galatians where Paul mentions that he upbraids Peter. From what we know of Peter's life, he eventually settled in Rome and became the first bishop of Rome. And we believe that during Nero's persecution, Peter lost his life. And because they were going to crucify him, and Peter declared that he didn't think himself worthy to be crucified in the same manner as his Lord, the tradition says that he was crucified upside down. And we might ask the question, was meeting Jesus a good thing for Peter or not? If Jesus had never called Peter, he quite likely would have continued to be a fisherman in the Galilee. We know he had a wife, who quite likely had children, probably had grandchildren, and would have led a reasonable, successful life in the Galilee. But instead, he follows Jesus, and it cost him plenty. After the resurrection, we're going to be spending the next number of weeks in the book of 1 Peter in the New Testament. And whereas with many things in the New Testament, there's always debates about authorship, the tradition has long held that this book, in fact, comes from Peter. We don't know the level of Peter's Greek, but it was common, as we see in the Gospel of Mark, for people to have scribes to write for them. And so the church has long attributed this book to Peter himself. Now, Peter is writing to a group of Christians, probably somewhere in the middle of what is today called Turkey. And as we go through the book, you're probably going to notice a number of interesting things about it. One of the things that this is verses 3 through 9, those of you who are in some of my Bible studies or adult Sunday school class might recognize the thing I do sometimes with biblical texts. In English, you all learn in grade school how to construct English sentences. There's usually subject, verb, predicate, and we all get accustomed to this. Greek sentences work a little bit differently. And actually, in Greek, you could very much argue that verses 3 to 9 are one large sentence. And if you in school were to give a sentence like this, your teacher would mark it up and say, run on, and run to chop it up. And so your English Bibles will render this, in fact, as multiple sentences. But one of the things you do when you learn Greek is you learn to hunt for the verbs. And so the verbs that are in blue and highlighted with the double box around them are actually the indicative verbs. And a number of the other verbs that have the double underlining are participles, which are dependent clauses. And so what I want you to see from Peter in this first paragraph, which is also a sentence, of the letter he writes, is the main verbs tell the main story that Peter wants to say. And if you look at the main verbs in that whole first sentence, what you will see is rejoice and love and rejoice. Because what we see from Peter, which is indicative of all of the other apostles, now the only apostle that maybe died a death, an old age of natural causes, maybe, is John, who also died in prison. Nearly all of the apostles died young. Nearly all of the apostles were imprisoned at some point. And nearly all of the apostles died for their faith. And again, you might say, well, was meeting Jesus a good thing for them? Well, if you listen to the apostles, it seems the message of all of them is, was my life shorter because of Jesus? Probably. Was there a lot more drama and chaos in my life because of Jesus? Probably. But I never would turn back. Why? Because he changed me. And what went out with the early church is this. The resurrection changed my life. N.T. Wright is a New Testament scholar, one of the most prominent New Testament scholars today. He has a very fat book called The Resurrection of the Son of God. N.T. Wright's thesis is, you cannot explain the Christian church apart from the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. Almost all scholars today of the New Testament, not all, most of them, the vast majority, whether or not they're believers, whether or not they believe that Jesus actually rose, almost all have come to the agreement that the only way to really explain the behavior and the change of lives of these people that went for Jesus is they believe they saw him in the flesh, and it completely changed their world. They all suffered. They all lost, but they didn't have regret. Rejoice, love, rejoice, because Jesus came out of the grave. Let's walk through that a little bit this morning. He begins, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth. This word shows up twice in the New Testament. It's a little bit, you might be thinking of the Gospel of John when we talked about Nicodemus and you must be born again, born from above. But this is a different word. New birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. For Peter, that empty tomb completely changed his perspective on life. It changed his path. It changed his destiny. It changed his career. Everything about his life would change because of the empty tomb. Now, this word new birth is important, and in subsequent Sundays we're going to talk about this, because in the Roman world, as in really our world today, even though we don't like to admit it, a lot of your life is determined by your birth. Who you were born to, when you were born, where you were born, what status your parents were. Where you were born, when you were born, for many of us determines the shape of our lives. And what happens with Peter is he says, what you have in Jesus Christ is new birth. And that will mean a change in everything. Your status, your perspective, how you think, for the rest of your life. Now, he says this is a new beginning. This is a new status, a new start. Into a living hope. Some of you might recognize this name, John Sook. John Sook was a very prominent pastor in the Christian Reformed Church. Actually, when I was in seminary, John Sook owned the house I rented from, the apartment I rented from him in Grand Rapids. He and his wife lived upstairs. John graduated from Catholic Seminary. He's originally from Canada. He went on to pastor a number of congregations in the CRC. He taught theology in the Philippines, was a foreign missionary, and became editor of the Banner. A number of years ago, he wrote a book called Not Sure, A Pastor's Journey from Faith to Doubt. And in this book, he declares that he no longer believes a lot of the things he was certain of when he was a young pastor. He's not sure about Jesus' resurrection. He's not sure about the authority of the Bible. He's not sure about God. Today, he continues to blog, and in fact, he and I often will, he's my Facebook friend, and we often chat back and forth on Facebook. In a post on the resurrection, he wrote, "What? People still believe in the physical resurrection? I've been a mainline minister for years by now, and neither I nor my parishioners in a healthy, growing church buy into such interpretations." That, of course, led to a long discussion on my Facebook feed, and he sent me a private note apologizing for causing the drama. I said, "It's okay, John. I love to talk about this stuff." When I think about Peter, I think about John Soap. And I don't think Peter would go there with John. I don't think Peter would give up a flourishing career. I don't think Peter would get into all of the drama that was in the New Testament church. I don't think Peter would hang on a cross upside down if he didn't see that empty tomb, if he didn't see Jesus eating that fish, if he didn't touch Jesus' hand, if he didn't see Jesus ascend, if he didn't believe that this resurrection of Jesus gave Peter a license to live his life in a radically new way that everyone else in the Roman world thought is irresponsible. This radical new way that said, you know what? I can pour out my life for Jesus now, not being overly concerned with money or health or all the other things going in my life, because I believe I have been given in his resurrection a new birth. And it means more than just what I should do or shouldn't do. It means more than just the way I can get God or the gods to give me what I want. I believe being sure matters. It doesn't mean that there aren't any doubts in our mind. It doesn't mean that we don't wake up in the middle of the night and wonder. It doesn't mean any of those. But for Peter, being sure meant the course of his life. So Peter continues. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth and a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. What did Peter believe? Peter believed very much what Jesus said, when Jesus said, "Don't store up treasure on earth where moth and rust consume." Now, when Jesus talks about moth and rust, and Peter talks about can never perish, spoil, or fade, they're talking about what we call the age of decay. That in fact, everything you build in this world will in fact come down. All the money you save in this world will be either spent by you or someone else, or taken by the government, or perhaps stolen. That whatever you try to accumulate and secure in this world cannot last. And so Peter says, what we have seen in the resurrection, what we have been given, is an inheritance that can never spoil or fade. And the idea isn't so much that it's kept in heaven for us to go up to, but in fact, with the second coming of Jesus, it's kept in heaven so that when he comes again, we will receive it. It's called an inheritance because it's not something we've earned. It's something that's given to us based on what someone else has earned and given on our behalf. And Peter is saying, the shape of my life, the loss of my life, all the things I've done in my life that to everyone around me seems to cost so much, to me, it's nothing because I have an inheritance. inheritance that is more secure than gold, is more secure than investments, is more secure than a company or a family or all of these things. I have an inheritance that cannot be taken away. They can imprison me. They can clean out my pockets. They can take my health. They can take my life. But this can't be touched. And you see, we haven't even gotten to the rejoice word yet. But Peter is already taking us there. This week, the big news was, of course, Aaron Hernandez hanging himself in prison. And one commentator, one sports commentator, made the comment, he was a huge player. He threw it away. Why? He couldn't escape his past, his friends from his high school, college, whether it was gang-related. He was brought down by the life he couldn't outrun. Leave the bad influences behind. And so his idea was you get all of the young rookies together in the NFL and you say, this is a new day. You have a new life. Don't be dragged down by the people of your past. You need to leave your past behind. And you have a great future in the National Football League. And when I heard that, I thought, oh, yeah. Except that the fact that report after report comes out that between 3 and 7 years after retirement in the National Football League, 80% of their players have to declare bankruptcy. You have a great future in the National Football League. Now, it is an amazing opportunity, but it goes to illustrate, can we really have these things? Would Peter have been better being drafted into the National Football League or following Jesus? How do you evaluate these things? How do you measure these things? Here comes the first big verb. In all of this, you greatly rejoice, Peter says to his readers. Though now, for a little while, you may have to suffer grief of all kinds of trials. And right away, Peter is setting us up for the message of this book. And Peter is writing this book to people who suffer. Peter is writing this book to people who have loss. Peter is writing this book to people who on one hand say, I have new life into a living hope, bought with the raised body of Jesus Christ, who gives me an inheritance which is secure in heaven, even while I suffer now, I rejoice. These have come so that, meaning the trials, so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Now, it's easy to say these words, but it's hard to live. Now, I don't think this dynamic of appreciating suffering in retrospect is a hard thing for us to know. As I look out on this room, I know many of your stories. I know what many of you have suffered. And probably what many of you would tell me is, what have your sufferings got you? And you would say, they've got me wisdom. They've got me depth. They've given me ballast. I am not the same person having endured suffering that I was before. And Peter changes this and takes this to another level and says, God brings you through fire to refine you, to perfect you, to take that faith that maybe when you were young was just a seed, but now that you have suffered, is worth more than gold. Do you look back and say, oh boy, am I sure thankful and happy about that suffering I did? No. But you look back on it and say, but God used those things to change me, to make me both more able to love, more sensitive to people's pain, and more stable in the midst of pain to not lose my bearings. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. And right there it is, the Christian life. The Christian life is this strange mixture of joy, not necessarily circumstantial, not necessarily experiential, but joy at being given a gift and a promise that over the years gets more and more tangible, and at the same time, suffering, where you experience the normal losses of living in this world, where you experience the losses of deciding to follow Jesus and what that costs you, where you experience the losses of various kinds, sometimes because of your faith. And right here in the midst of it is the Christian life, joy and suffering at the same time. But even though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your soul. Now that last verse sounds a little bit like a Christian cliche, but the Greek is in fact quite a bit more nuanced and complex. Because what the English is trying to render here is the telos, the end goal, the culmination, the completion of your faith, which in fact is the salvation of, now in Greek, this word that is rendered in English souls is your psuche, which is the basis of the English word psyche. This is the basis, so you are receiving by your faith the goal of yourself, the goal of your being, the goal of your soul. But what's Peter saying? Well, what is your goal in life? Is your goal to build a big pile of money? Peter is saying, you can do that, and you might get to spend it all, or someone else might spend it all, or someone might take it, or the government might take it. A big pile of money? That's not a good goal. What is your goal in life? To have the best time I possibly can at any given moment? Well, besides being an extremely selfish goal, you're always at the subject of circumstance. What Peter is saying, the goal of your faith is in fact the rescue of yourself, that you become something which this world finds remarkable, a person that can endure suffering, a person that can endure trial, a person that, in fact, when everyone is losing their head around them, can stay calm because they know their greatest treasure cannot be put at risk by the circumstances of this world. That the one that you love is actually your Lord. Even though you haven't seen him, you love him. And your life is targeted to him. And this then becomes, as Paul says, your life. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that has come to you searched intensely with greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstance which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when they predicted the sufferings of the Messiah and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you when they spoke of the things that have now been told by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels look into these things. And that last verse is so poignant because what Peter is saying, the drama you get to live as a Christian is what even angels are envious of. They're fascinated by it. Even angels who stand before the throne of God, when they look upon what happens in the earth, marvel at what they see as the Christian life, and embodied in this case by Peter, who had all of the makings of a nice life in the Galilee, who throws it all away pray for what? For Jesus. To die how? On a Roman club, on a Roman cross. With regret? No. With joy. And so the angels look at this and marvel. As we're going to see as we continue to get into this book, because Peter's going to have a lot to say about a lot of things that sound to us to be very strange. To this world, you are born into a structure that you are not likely to overcome. You might have succeeded within parameters. You might have done well for yourself as compared to others in your class. But for the most part, most of us are going to live lives that are unremarkable. And this world will pay no attention to us after we're gone, even to the degree that it pays attention to us now. We are born into it. And the age of decay will win. Every love is broken by death or betrayal. Every accomplishment flourishes for a while and then is forgotten and its fruits distributed. Any achievement may feel great in the moment. Think about Jim Carrey and that clip I've played a couple of times where he's standing up there on the Golden Globe stage saying, I'm two-time award, Golden Globe winner Jim Carrey. And what's in the back of his mind is, I want to be three times. Think about Robin Williams winning the Oscar. And a week later, someone says, hey, Mark, and he realized the Oscar buzz only lasted for a week. This is life. In this world, don't let anyone fool you. Now, Peter says you are born anew into a new reality by this resurrection. Paul will say in the book of Romans, you are baptized into his death and resurrection in your baptism. It will always involve suffering. It did for Jesus, it will for you. If someone says, become a Christian and be happy all the time, and God will protect you from all evil, don't buy it. It isn't true. It wasn't true of the apostles. It wasn't true of Jesus. It isn't true. But what he gives for us in the resurrection is something that transcends the circumstances of this life. And he says your inheritance is secure outside of the age of decay. Kept safe for your future, it can't be touched. And what that means is that you have something that this world cannot give. Daniel isn't around this morning because we had one of our regular fallouts this week. Daniel and I have a fallout at least once a month. He had a lot of stuff on your board notice last week, Sunday, on the sidewalk in front of my office. And I was busy Monday and Tuesday, and finally Wednesday I came in, all of this stuff was there, so I packed up all the stuff, and I put it on his cart, and I put it out on the street. And he came back, and he was terribly angry and furious at me, and cussed me out, and called me all kinds of names of all kinds of genders and all kinds of races. And and we go through that. This is part of my relationship with Daniel. Why put up with it? Why not figure out a way to get rid of Daniel? Why not? Why should I? Doesn't he belong to God? Doesn't God care for him? He calls me all kinds of names. So what? Can he threaten me? So then one guy came when Daniel was chewing me out, one guy from the neighborhood parked behind me to watch to make sure Daniel didn't hit me or anything, and he didn't. But he said, oh, he was over by your car, and Daniel hurt my car, sure. One of these days, can Daniel snap and do something against me? Yeah, it can happen. But again, here's the Christian life. What can Daniel take from me? Really? This is Peter's vision. Can you see how this vision can lead you to forgive someone who has hurt you in horrible ways? The other option is bitterness. Does that help? Can you see how none of this is based on accomplishment? We don't earn Jesus' love. We simply have it. It's not threatened by our failures. What we have in Christ is that you are free to be generous. You can befriend the friendless. You are not in competition with others, because how do you really compete for love? How do you compete for inheritance? They're just given. You can have a new morality not by using people, which is how we tend to do in this world, but by loving them, whether or not they deserve it. This is the fruit of the Christian life. This is what Peter sees. And as Peter walks us through a lot of the different relationships we have in this world, this is what Peter will say. Was I a successful fisherman in the Galilee? Yes. Well, except that every time we find him, he's not catching fish. But there are other reasons for that in the Bible. Was it worth it giving up that life? Yes. Why? Because Peter became refined. And God did things through him that he never could have imagined he would do. And it's all because of the resurrection and Peter's belief in it and his trust in it. And how that remade and reshaped him. And you might think, wow, that's an exciting thing. But it's no less available to every one of us. That's the amazing thing of the gospel. Lord, on one hand, we look at the fruit of the gospel. The ability to be stable when everyone else loses their head. The ability to turn the other cheek. The ability to be generous to people who in many ways don't deserve it. And we look at that and we say, it's beautiful. But yet the basis for it, we look at and say, well, I don't think I want that. I want to be in control of my life. I want to be in control of others. I want my circumstances to go well. And Lord, all of those are natural things. But you come to us and you offer us your word. You tell us that your resurrection is just the first fruit of our own. You promise us, if we follow you, we will reign with you over a renewed heaven and earth. And you give all of this to us, not by our achievement, but by your grace. Help us, Lord, to learn your grace. Help us, Lord, to receive your gifts. Help us, Lord, to live out this kind of life that Peter chose. Help us, Lord, to learn this path, which is the strange combination of joy and suffering. And may your kingdom continue to come. May your tribe continue to grow. And may we look forward to the day that we receive that inheritance, which is held secure, safe from all the ravages of the age of decay. May we live out that joy in the midst of suffering, together with you. Amen. When you share.